absolutely demolished them, 48-7. Then Nick Foles was still on the bench, and their playoff push had not begun. Now Nick Foles off the bench, behind center, and his teammates are making him shrines. All right, Bart, how did the Eagles pull off this upset?
Well, they have to take a close look at what they didn't do well last game, which is everything. It's hard to beat a team twice, right?
Bart, are you okay with the fact that the Eagles, they didn't watch the film initially after the big blowout and everything?
Yeah, I mean, when we got blew out by the Patriots 45-3, we buried the football and vowed never to mention it again. And then we went into Gillette and we won in the divisional round, you know, in the playoffs.
Oh, that's similar circumstance.
Yeah, they buried the ball.
Yeah, no, they didn't actually bury the ball. I'm saying you guys lost a game by 42. They lost a game by 41. They're playing on the road in the divisional round against that same opponent.
Yeah, this is going to be a closer game, and I think they're going to make the adjustments. And I'm curious to see what they do with Michael Bennett, because I think he may be the key. Fletcher Cox, you know he's a beast inside. Mm-hmm. But I think they need to consider moving Bennett over those guards, because he's strong enough against the run, but he causes so many problems with his – with his penetration. And you think about when Alvin Kamara is in, it's more of a zone scheme.
Yes.
You know, and the zone scheme is about penetration. That's how you stop it. We call it setting the edge from the inside. You can write that down. You know, we call that setting the edge from the inside.
Right.
Opposed to when it's a power scheme, when Ingram's in, it's more double teams and movement getting up to the linebackers. So I think the key could be moving Bennett in the inside to cause those problems, opposite of Fletcher Cox, to allow you to be able to get more penetration. When Kamara's in, you have to understand what back's in and what they like to do out of those certain personnel groupings and things of that sort. And on the other side, Nick Foles, they're going to have to run the football, but they're going to have to get in the rhythm. And we're going to have to see what kind of coverage they decide to play, because when Nick Foles goes to those RPOs, their linebackers have to respect it. Let's see if the Saints decide to go with an invert safety to try and play that lurk type of coverage, mm-hmm. so that they can protect those linebackers and allow them to scrape and play free.
What Chicago did.
Right.
If I'm the Saints, is there a chance on the RPOs they just, for the most part, until the Eagles prove they are actually going to run the ball, they just disregard the run part of the run pass option?
Well, I think you don't disregard, but I think you disrespect Nick Foles, because you know he's not Carson Wentz. He's not a threat to keep the ball and really hurt you that way. He doesn't really want to run it. So you want to flatten down that defensive end to be able to, you know, try and get some tackles for a loss. And that's the game that you play, because you know that he's not really a legitimate threat to pull it and actually keep it and run. He's trying to do that to see, you know, it's a run pass option, to see if those, you know, if those linebackers step up to be able to get that voided zone behind them.
The biggest thing and the biggest problem with the RPOs for defensive players, just like Bart, it's just like your natural instincts. You know, Bart, I throw a punch at him, he's going to flinch. Now, as a defender, regardless of what you should, because if I put that ball in the running back's pocket and that offensive lineman fires out and down, everything that you have seen since you've been playing football at a high level has told you it's going to be a run. Even though the quarterback is not put the fear in you that he's going to run like Lamar Jackson, everything that they see says run, 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 and they take those two false steps, and that allows those seams to be created behind it. So that's kind of the trick to the RPOs and why they really work.
I want to ask you guys a question about a name we haven't mentioned much yet, but he might be the most important player for the Saints, not named Drew Brees. What are the Eagles going to do about Michael Thomas? I know the secondary's played better the last month of the season, but they still don't have a corner that you can say, we're just going to leave you on Michael Thomas. I feel like most of their game plan is going to be about slowing down Alvin Kamara. So Thomas, it's not even like they can build a game plan around stopping him, because Kamara can wreck you in two different ways. What do you do with Michael Thomas in this football game?
You play complex coverage against him, right? You want to get up in his face, because he's not he's a big guy, but he's not an elusive guy. You want to try and throw off his time and hope that this pass rush can get there. And then you're going to do different things, right? Sometimes you bring that safety in the box, but then he's swiping out. Right? And when I say swiping out, that means he's taking anything short, slants, and that allows the corner to know that he can play deep. So then next time you come down, you have that same guy, and then he plays high, safety gets back. It's all about pre-snap, you know, disguise and being able to do the things of that sort. You got to be able to say, okay, somebody's going to have the heavy lifting. So I take my best corner, whoever that is, he goes on the second guy, right? Mm-hmm. Because you know if you put your best guy on Michael Thomas, it could be a draw. Yes. Day of the draw, those are big plays. All he has to do is get a couple explosives.
But that other receiver has an advantage going against your second guy.
Which is Ted Ginn, right? And he's pretty much a one-trick pony a lot of times. We know that he's a vertical guy. You know, you just want to play off. He's added a couple more routes to his route tree. But I take my best guy, say my best guy should be able to stop their second guy. I take my second guy and I give him safety help all over the place. Wherever he's in line, I make sure that I give him complex coverages. If linebackers are there, I'm late to the run. And I just want to go back for a second to what CeCe was talking about when you talk about Nick Foles and the RPOs. What happens as a linebacker, no matter what, even if I know that it's a trick, because it's going to look like it's run pass, because linemen get 2 yards before they get to upfield, before it's considered, you know, legal man downfield. Mm-hmm. But as a linebacker, it just causes pause. So even if I don't fall for it, when he takes it out, I can't get back and get my linebacker depth. So that means the receivers already got behind me. So that's what makes it difficult, because I can't really get my linebacker depth. With your linebacker depth, if you're a good linebacker, when you see zones, you want to drop 10 to 12 yards, because those are where the routes are determined. If a guy's coming in, it's usually determined at 10 to 12, sometimes 15. But then when you do that, you end up short at like 7. And then now they're at 12 when you're supposed to be at 12. And now you can't really be in that window. You put tremendous pressure on the safeties who has to stay deep.
I'm going to give Philadelphia something else to do if you don't want to have one of your corners travel, because neither one of the corners are dominant. I would just let Mike or Tom, I'd let him get his stuff. I'd let him get his shots.
Really?
I would just try not to let him get 40.
Yep.
But I would let him get his shots, and I'm going to shut down everything else. I'm going to play, make sure everything in front of me as far as Teddy Ginn, because Michael Thomas in catching the ball. So what if he catches 10? I don't want him to catch 10 for 180. So once he catches it, I want him on the ground. He can catch 10 for 110, but you can't give up those big plays to the other receivers. You can't give up those big shots, because I just believe Philadelphia, just keep everything in front of you and allow that rush to take advantage of some of that inside pressure and trying to get to Drew Brees.
So it sounds like as long as they can slow down the Saints a little bit, you guys think the Eagles have a chance here?
Oh, listen. I
didn't say all that.
Well,
because I don't really know much of what you
said. Here's what I think. I think that this is a game that Doug Peterson is almost built to coach in, because he always wants to be the underdog. He wants to be the guy that you need trick plays, you need to go for it on fourth down, you need to take big chances. And so we have seen in limited sample, when they're the favorite, when they just need to go with a standard game plan, they haven't thrived. But in a game where they are a decided underdog, where they are going to have to make big plays on both sides of the ball, I do trust Doug Peterson in that spot to have his team ready. And we have seen from the Eagles, I don't think they're going to have the mentality of, let's just make sure we don't get blown out. In the first matchup, one of the reasons they got blown out is Carson Wentz threw 3 picks. This could be a game Nick Foles throws 3 picks. That's got to be on the board, because you are going to have to take chances. You are going to have to take shots. You are going to have to try to make big chunk game-changing plays on both sides of the ball that leave you susceptible to the opposite happening. Like, that's why this is such a tough game to pick. Could I see the Eagles winning? Yeah, they could. Could I see the Saints winning by 21 points? Absolutely. Like, the Eagles, to me, best chance is a game plan that allows them the possibility of getting blown out.
Yeah, I believe that the Eagles, especially their defense, you can't give the Saints 2 options. So I believe you put people in the box, take the Saints out of their running game. Because the last 2 years, what do the Saints want to do? They want to be able to pound the football. So as you mentioned, they need to be able to get in the gaps and get tackles for losses on first down. Their secondary can be had. So I'm concerned about their secondary and how they match up with Sean Payton. I believe after the bye, I believe Teron Armstead being healthy as far as their left tackle. He's got a torn pec. So he's not going to be healthy until he gets surgery. I believe that the Saints get back to the Saints that we saw in week number 2 to about week number 13. All right? Those are the Saints I believe show up on Sunday, and I believe that this is the end of the Nick Foles shrine. Magic.
Well, you have to have Magic a plan for Kamara too, right? So what happens is, if he's offset and I'm a defensive end, don't worry about going to get the sack. I need you to chip him, and I need him to have to release inside of you, because I can't have him isolated against my linebacker. So I got to make sure I have him bracketed. You just look at me. So that means if he swings, that means you get up Phil as a defender. Don't run by him. You chip him to make sure that he can't get out of the
rush. And that slows down your pass rush, but it tries to prevent Alvin Kamara from having a wheel route go for 40-yard touchdown.
Right,
like,
exactly.
Which we saw when Alvin Kamara wasn't a wheel route, but we saw him get out on Malcolm Jenkins in the first game, have a big game. So you got to sacrifice something, but it's to prevent the big play.
All right, take a break.
She drawing over there. I'm like, I'll show you
a little bit later on. Coming up, how can Amari Cooper dominate the Rams secondary? We'll talk Amari next on First Things First.
I want you to write something down. Write it down.